We've been following the tax story as far as the implications for FIIs go. I'm talking about the general anti-avoidance rule. There's been a lot of talk around that. What will that do for portfolio flows, FDI flows, and all other kinds of investments into India, especially routed through the Mauritius route and other tax havens, so as to speak. Will the tax department be able to go after all these transactions, even if they are covered by tax treaties, without any problems? I caught up with T.P. Oswal, senior partner T.P. Oswal and Associates, well-known tax expert on this issue yesterday. Listening to a short bit of that conversation that I had with him yesterday, and then come back. You've been pretty clear, as I understand, that post GAR in the finance bill, Mauritius as a route for sort of routing money into India, I mean, is over. That game is over.
Yes.
It no longer is available.
Absolutely right. You see, we have provisions in the GAR, General Anti-Avoidance Rules, which have been introduced in Section 95, 96, 97, 200, in which it is very clearly provided that the tax gatherer can ignore the location of the asset, the place of residence, or any other party to the transaction. So the place of residence of FII will be ignored. And you have the specific provision under Section 98, which also says that we have a right to recharacterize your or re-decide where is the place of your residence. So therefore, if today you are coming from Mauritius, you are an American investor, you are coming from Mauritius, they may say yes, Mauritius treaty will benefit will not be available, and if the Mauritius treaty benefit is not available, then under the American treaty you are liable to tax anyway on the short term and long term capital gains in India as well as in USA. And this probability cannot be ruled out, because the use of the treaty which is beneficial is provided under Section 90 subsection 2. Now subsection 2A, which has been introduced in this finance bill, which says if the GAR provisions are invoked against any taxpayer, then that taxpayer cannot use the beneficial provisions of the treaty which are provided under Section 90 subsection 2 of the Income Tax Act. In other words, once the GAR is invoked, you will not take any shelter of the tax treaty. So if that happens, let me tell you, all FIIs are heading for a trouble, whether you are in Mauritius, you are in Cyprus, or in Singapore. Everybody will have to pay short-term capital gain tax in India. Long-term capital gain, of course, they may not pay because it is a listed shares which are exempted in the hands of all investors.
Yes, we are. But you know, the basic assumption which is being made is the fact that most use locations like Cyprus or Mauritius or others just purely for tax avoidance purposes.
Yes,
I mean that's the basic assumption we are making, and that's the reason why there is reason to panic. There's reason to actually.
You see the
yes.
Absolutely correct. The Section 95 very clearly defines a term called as impermissible avoidance transaction. Any transaction which is motivated to take tax benefit will be considered to be impermissible avoidance transaction. And whatever the substance test which Supreme Court had laid down in the case of Vodafone has also been reversed in the GAR provisions. The GAR provisions as introduced today are more draconian than they were in the direct tax code. Now what it is said is that a commercial purpose of coming through a particular jurisdiction will no more be considered as a commercial purpose. And second thing, if you are coming through a Mauritius and you are taking the tax treaty advantage, the advantage under the treaty or under the domestic law as the case may be, then they say this is the transaction is motivated to take the tax benefit, and therefore it will be impermissible avoidance transaction. And if it is impermissible avoidance transaction, then the commissioner can recharacterize the transaction, can ignore your place of residence, can ignore in your location, etc., etc. All other consequences will come true. Therefore, in India, if you want to now do a business, safely assume that you will be paying short-term capital gain tax, and then do the business. It is your luck later on, after filing your return, you don't pay, you get a refund. But getting a refund also is considered to be a tax benefit.
All right, T.P. Oswal, they're very strong thoughts on the matter. Dinesh Kanabar, Chairman Tax at KPMG, also spoke with us, listening to a short bit of that conversation.
In a sense, one cannot take an objection to GAR per se, as it signifies the shift of the economy. But the key question is that there are companies which have set up operations in Mauritius. There are investments which have been made prior to the point of time that GAR has come in. And the question is, are we at least grandfathering what has already happened?
Okay.
Because any time a shift happens, if you are not going to provide for transition in an orderly manner, then you are going to create chaos. So I would per se believe that GAR is a matter of time. It has to happen. And this is as good a time as any. What the government needs to do is two things. First, it needs to really provide for grandfathering provisions so that existing investments are not disturbed. That was on the basis of existing regulations. If you have a panel there, can that panel include an industry representative, if not somebody from the judiciary? So we are looking at commercial transactions and there is a commercial input there.